Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is for the months of July, August, and September of 2015. It's a series entitled Biblical Missionaries. How many missionaries could you identify in the Bible? Well, we're going to talk about Daniel and his friends today. It's lesson number 5 in this series for August 1 of 2015. And before we begin, I hope you have your Bible handy and if you're able to get it readily available. We're going to look at several passages. We'd like to ask you to bow your heads with us as we begin. Our wonderful Father, as we look at these experiences of so many years ago, the stories of Daniel and his three friends and others, may we gain from them insights into your character, your nature, what you do, how you relate to us, and best of all, how we can become more like you is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we've mentioned, this lesson will focus on the experiences of Daniel and his friends primarily in the royal courts of Babylon.
Now, why would they call them missionaries? Don't you have to have a mission to go out? Do you have a mission when you leave somewhere to do something? These people were like Daniel. He was kind of confiscated and taken away. And
well,
it looks like to me like he was just surviving, just playing out his faith and his beliefs. He didn't really have a mission there. He just went and did it.
Well, but think about this now. If you had been Daniel, probably a late teenager, and suddenly the enemy comes, surrounds a city, conquers a city, and you're taken along with several others, and you're considered to be the cream of the crop, the king's relatives and the very best in the country, and you're taken off to Babylon, and you know that the intention is for you to represent your nation in the courts of Babylon. Wouldn't you consider that a mission?
Yeah, but that wasn't my mission. That wasn't his mission.
That was
it was just kind of...
Whether he liked it or not, that was his mission.
It was default.
He kind of pushed into it.
Yeah.
I think missionaries is one of those English names that has more than one meaning.
Well,
they stuck to their guns and they kept at it the whole time they were there. At least we know Daniel did. We didn't hear much more about the others.
Well, what a lot of people don't recognize is missionary is the Latin word for apostle. It means an ambassador. It means someone who's sent out to represent, in this case, it would be God. And some of them were not sent. I mean, we look at some others. Does Joseph voluntarily where he was? Was Esther voluntarily where she was? No, none of them were voluntarily where they wanted it, where they were, as far as we know.
You don't need the general conference to give you a telephone call to have a mission.
Yeah, you need an enemy to come and take you out of your house and throw
well,
you
might
into...
That might be our future, so don't don't laugh about it.
Well, I was just wondering about the word missionary, if it was really appropriate or not. Maybe it is.
You can have Uncle Sam give you a draft notice.
Yes.
Yes.
End up in the military.
So just quickly, when someone mentions the name Daniel, do you think of the stories, the miracle stories, or do you think of the prophecies?
Both?
Yeah. Depends
on your age.
I see. Yeah.
If you're little, you remember Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach.
Yeah, if you're little, but you're a child, then probably, yes.
You get to be older, then they start throwing those prophecies at you.
I see. Well, we know that the book of Daniel was a formative, very formative, in the experience of William Miller, and of course, William Miller's experiences were, and his preaching and so forth, were foundational for the Seventh-day Adventist Church, so Daniel should be pretty important to us, right?
Definitely.
Which chapters in Daniel have prophecies, major prophecies in them?
2, 7, 8, and 9, and 10 and 12.
Okay, 10 through 12 is really sort of together,
right.
Could you summarize a little bit about what these prophecies are all about? Is there some kind of theme to those prophecies?
end time events.
Yeah, it seems
messianic in nature.
Yeah, they cover a long time periods in general. They progress to in a direction, and basically that direction is toward the end of the world, isn't it?
Well, it depends who you talk to.
Yeah.
But
you're making note of the fact that there's a lot of people who don't believe that even God can predict the future. So if you believe that not even God can predict the future, then you have a real problem with the Book of Daniel. And
reason why they don't believe that God can predict the future is because that's their idea of what freedom really is. If you have a being that knows the future, well then you're not really free to do anything. You're gonna carry out whatever he says.
So what these people are really saying is, if God is able to do something that they can't do, it's not possible. In other words, they're saying God can't do anything better than they, and that's just complete. I mean, basically, they're putting themselves on a par with God.
Well, it's just like if I say that you're going to do such and such, mm-hmm. and then you end up doing it, did you really do it because of freedom, or did you do it because the Lord was
stirring you around?
Yeah, just pulling your puppet strings to make it happen.
Also, yeah. Some people use Genesis 6:6, I think. Mm-hmm. To kind of base that kind of thought, that God, because when God said he regretted making humans, mm-hmm. some people focus on that one to say that, you know, well, how can you regret something if you already knew the outcome? Mm-hmm.
So why would God give us this information about what's going to happen in the future in this way?
So when you see that thing come to fruition, that you know that God is who he is, and that only he could tell the future. That's it's not for the purpose of us understanding what the future is. It's so when something happens that was prophesied, then we can have more confidence in what
we're told
prophecy is.
Two times and a third time almost says the same words in the Gospel of John, saying, I predict things so that when they happen, you'll recognize that I knew in advance what was coming.
Spiritual roadmap.
Mm-hmm. Well, what do we know about the coming of the Babylonians to the kingdom of Judah?
Well, it was predicted they were to come.
Mm-hmm.
And God was sending them there. And Jeremiah and other prophets told the nation that this is going to happen, and you need to cooperate with it.
And Hezekiah mm-hmm. gave him a carrot to think about when they came yep. and visited. He showed them all the wealth he had, and that really put the lid on their plans to come get it.
Mm-hmm. Well, and what was their idea when they came to Jerusalem the first time? The king said, okay, I want you to pick out a group of the best young men. We're going to take them back to Babylon.
You're talking about the first captivity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Take them back to Babylon. We're going to take them to the royal court. We're going to train them in the ways of Babylon. Of course, their idea was that they would become Babylonian citizens, that they would adopt the Babylonian religion, then learn the language, etc., and then they would represent Babylon back to their own people. That was their idea.
So Babylon was really the missionary.
Yeah.
No.
Well, they had a mission. You just said it.
Yeah, totally no, I'm not different. Arguing with that.
Totally different.
Very
well,
different guy.
That's what I was talking about. You know, what is the definition of a missionary?
Mm-hmm. So. Well, we know the famous story about Daniel and his three friends. What did they do soon after they got to Babylon? They were offered the king's very special food, and they said what?
No.
And they took their lives in their hands by saying, we're not going to eat what the king offers.
Why?
Because some of the food
him.
Was...
You didn't question him.
Oh, because some of the food had been offered to idols.
Yeah. There's two reasons that are given why they didn't eat that food. One reason is because it was food that were, they, it included food that they as Hebrews weren't supposed to eat. But a more important reason, I'm sure, was the food had been offered to idols. And they said, we're not going to eat food that had been offered to idols. And why didn't they want to eat food that was offered to idols?
That's how they were raised. Somebody gave them a good grounding somewhere.
There's got to be some kind of an implication there.
Yes.
Yes, yeah.
The implication is if you eat the food that's been offered to idols, if you succeed, it's because the idols have blessed you. And they didn't want any part of that. Well, think of what, and obviously we don't have time to go through all the details of Daniel's life, but in the diet, what they succeeded in eating only healthy stuff, and you know what the results were? They faced Nebuchadnezzar. He faced Nebuchadnezzar with an unpopular message. He read the writing on the walls of the writing on the handwriting on the wall for Belshazzar, and even in Medo-Persia. He chose to worship openly when he knew what the law said. He knew very well what the law said. What kind of courage does it take to do that?
A lot.
Would you open your windows and pray toward Jerusalem if you knew that that was the next thing that would happen is you'd be thrown to the lions? Or would you choose to pray in your closet?
Kind of hard to imagine me just doing that, but there may have been a spirit that was compelling them to do all this stuff. I mean, how would you decide that you were going to get thrown in the fiery furnace and have courage enough to do that? I think there's a lot of the spirit there that compelled them to do that.
Well, not only that, but if you follow the story, we were talking about the three Hebrews and the fiery furnace. Everybody bowed down except those three. There's every reason to believe that there were a lot of their fellow Hebrews. These were the only guys when all their buddies just bowed down.
Yep. Well, there's a part of the book of Daniel that a lot of people haven't actually looked at very carefully that I would like you to look at with me. It's the last part of Daniel 9. Look at this, starting from verse 16. Actually, this is Daniel's prayer. I'm going to start with verse 15. O Lord our God, now this is at a time Daniel knows that it's been almost 70 years since he was taken into captivity. And he knows about the prophecy of Jeremiah that said they were going to be there for 70 years. Okay? O Lord our God, you showed your power by bringing your people out of Egypt, and your power is still remembered. We have sinned. Now, we think of Daniel not so much as a sinner, but pretty much a saint, don't we? But here's Daniel associating himself with his people. We have sinned. We have done wrong. You have defended us in the past, so do not be angry with Jerusalem any longer. It is your city, your sacred hill. All the people in the neighboring countries look down on Jerusalem and on your people because of our sins and evil our ancestors did. Oh God, hear my prayer and pleading. Restore your temple, which has been destroyed. Restore it so that everyone will know that you are God. Listen to us, oh God. Look at us and see the trouble we are in, the suffering of the city that bears your name. We are praying to you because you are merciful, not because we have done right. Lord, hear us. Lord, forgive us. Lord, listen to us and act in order that everyone will know that you are God. Do not delay. This city and these people are yours. What's he trying to do here?
He's saying to God, we're serving you, but we don't want you to get a bad reputation, basically. It's time. Yeah. You said it was going to change. I'm reminding you.
How many times have you prayed for God's reputation?
What?
Not too many.
Why
what
is
kind
it,
of reputation does he have today?
Why is it that the temple is so important in emphasizing the goodness of God and what God is really like over what the people are like? Why why couldn't whoever they're trying to impress here, it seems to me that the proper thing that ought to be reflecting the real nature of God ought to be Daniel and his friends and everyone else, not some temple.
Yeah, but Solomon's temple was a pretty awesome building.
Well, I know that, but...
And the children of Israel in Jeremiah's day, and early in Jeremiah's day, early in Daniel's day too, for that matter, thought that God would, it was so special that God would never allow it even to be destroyed. Jeremiah 7, you know, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord here. They thought, if we just stay next to this temple, we'll be safe because no way God's going to let this temple be destroyed.
So how is it that the temple is a measure of the integrity of the people?
That's a very good question.
So well, I've never thought about that question
before. How would that apply in our day?
Well,
I go to a big, nice, fancy new church down here, so exactly. The Lord must be with us.
Of course.
That other congregation of Adventists up in Podunk up here, little old rundown place, that God must not be with them.
And what about places that I visited recently in some parts of the world where we own a very nice church, but we can't even worship in it because the government doesn't allow us to?
Well, the temple has a lot of meaning to it, and I don't think the meaning was quite there yet at that time. After all, Jesus says, destroy this temple, in 3 days I shall raise it up. There's some meaning that wasn't quite understood back then that started coming out later on of God living in this temple, which is us.
So. They were focused a lot of time on places like Mount Sinai and certain places. I think later on they learned that, you know, the Holy Spirit and God is everywhere instead of in a fixed place. So they placed a lot of emphasis on structures and places.
Mm-hmm. So we can put all a bit, of course, the purpose for us is to learn something about our situation. Why is it that there's been a relatively dramatic drop in the number of young people in this country and in westernized countries, basically, a significant drop in the number of them that who even recognize or are willing to call themselves Christians? What's going on? Why are young people today flocking away from the churches?
So what's the connection between the where we were before with that question?
Okay, well, we're talking about young people who stood up, were willing to walk into the fire,
whatever. Okay.
And what's happening with our young people today? They're not standing up, they're walking away. And why is it? And in terms of Babylon and their pagan gods, I mean, this country today, I mean, with evolution and all that kind of stuff going on, are we any better as a nation than Babylon was?
No. Are all the young people walking away?
Not all of them,
well,
but a lot of them are.
Well, if you remember the story there was only three of them there.
Yeah.
There must have been a lot of young people bowing to the image right there, so I don't think things have changed that much, has it?
Ellen White had some pretty stark words to say about this. These words are found in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 8, page 153. Every institution that bears the name of Seventh-day Adventist is to be the world as was Joseph in Egypt and as were Daniel and his fellows in Babylon. What does that mean? In the providence of God, these men were taken captive that they might carry to heathen nations the knowledge of the true God. They were to be representatives of God in our world. They were to make no compromise with the idolatrous nations with which they were brought in contact, but were to stand loyal to their faith, bearing as a special honor the name of worshipers of the God who created the heavens and the earth. Do we think of ourselves that way? Do the people around here recognize your fancy church that you worship in as a beacon of light?
Well,
I think
that never, if you think about it, that may have been the purpose of it all, but rarely was that the case, if ever.
Yes.
I think we could look at this in two ways, more specifically on our church, but if you look at the more recent history, and I'm saying as far back maybe as World War I and certainly after World War II, the world in a lot of ways was much more religious minded than it is today. And I know in my lifetime, I remember as a boy and seeing it, and then later when you start holding down a job and earning a living and all, each succeeding generation seemed like it had less exposure to anything religious from any religion as against the one before it. And we're reaping that across the board in this country, both in our church and everywhere. Mm-hmm. You can see the difference.
You know, the part that I'm not sure whether we should weep or whether we should laugh. But when a disaster happens in this country, see, if you listen to the media all the time, it's evolution and it's all this kind of stuff and da-da-da, you know, no, we don't believe in religion, da-da-da. And as soon as a disaster happens, what do they say?
Let's
all pray.
Yes.
What are they going to pray to, the mollusks or the monkeys, or what are they praying to?
Well, and it's always an act of God.
Yeah.
It's
<Yes.
laughs> created this disaster.
Well, now, seriously, what kind of life, what kind of spiritual life did Daniel and his friends maintain, which gave them such a close relationship with God? What did they learn from home?
Daniel, basically, I believe from his mother, learned the most, no? That's what I read.
Think how easy it would have been for Daniel and his friends simply to compromise or maybe just practice their religion in private. It would have been very easy for them to do that. Where would you place yourself on a scale of, okay, I'm compromising or I'm practicing in private versus I'm standing out like a Daniel? The question is for you out there as well.
Well, did Daniel stand out back in Jerusalem?
Well, he stood out enough so he got chosen.
Well, yeah, but they didn't pick him because he was being faithful to his...
They picked him because he was young and intelligent and good-looking and
smart and handsome and probably had credentials and
exactly.
So on and so forth. But I mean, you know, I was thinking here a second ago. I live in Loma Linda. I don't have all these heathen. It's a nice, polite, quiet. Everybody's nice here. I don't live across the tracks over here where everybody's shooting one another and beating up one another. And so... maybe if I lived over there, I'd stand out a little more. So
maybe we should spend more time over there.
You stand out in some part in Loma Linda as well. Yeah, the same thing
is.
That's over there now, Loma Linda is changing.
Yes, it
I moved here 14 years ago. The Loma Linda that exists now is changing. Mm-hmm. They have many of the same thing, but they're not as overt. And okay. People do see when you're a little different. I have a son who's 20, because we're talking about young people. My son is in church at least 3 times a week because he volunteers, he does this, he does that. He'll if I say I don't feel like going, he'll walk. He said, I have to go. Because it's in him. Some kids still do it. Well, as my daughter, however, she'll say, well, Mom, I don't believe anymore. Some people are hypocrites. And this and that. You know, it's different things. But I dare say there's some things in Loma Linda as well.
Yeah, well, there's people who move here because they realize it's a quiet, safe place.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
it's nice. I like that.
The thing that interests me about Daniel and his fellow prisoners, somebody back in Israel, I use that in a sort of wider sense, must have been still teaching some very basic stuff that was handed down. And then you come down to Christ's time, and the Pharisees have turned it all upside down.
Mm-hmm. Well, isn't it kind of our Adventist understanding, largely through Ellen White, that at least she emphasizes this as one of the reasons these people were taken to Babylon was so that they would be a witness, mm-hmm. that these people needed a witness. And They're getting a little cloistered and what have you, and that was part of the purpose of taking these people out, so that when we find ourselves in strained circumstances, environments that we don't particularly really would prefer to be in, sometimes I think we overlook the fact that, you know, God in His providence, and that's what it appears to us, as these circumstances have drug us over here, that there's a reason for mm-hmm. that. There's yeah. a reason for that. And in those circumstances, you are going to stand out, whether yeah. you, whereas back in Jerusalem, you didn't stand out maybe as much. Now you are really standing out. And that's the purpose of it.
Yeah. Well, the story of Daniel 2 is a fairly familiar one. What many people don't realize or haven't stopped to look at it carefully, Daniel and his three friends were still students at the, we call it the University of Babylon, whatever exactly that consisted of, when the king had that dream. No one could tell him what the dream was, and so he just arbitrarily declared, you guys are a bunch of fakes, a bunch of phonies. Every one of you is going to die. And they're still students. And they were included in the death decree. And Daniel says, hold on, wait. Let me talk to God tonight, and I'll give you the answer tomorrow. As a student. What does that teach us?
Sorry.
Go ahead.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Why is Daniel 2 possible down to in Aramaic? And not the Daniel the first chapter.
Yeah. The book of Daniel, from Daniel 1:1 to 2:4, is in Hebrew. Yeah. Starting in Daniel 2:4, he says, O king, live forever. When he starts doing that, he's speaking to the king in Aramaic. So it's written in Aramaic. And it stays in Aramaic till you get to Daniel 8, I think the end of Daniel 7, somewhere right about there.
No. And
Well, somewhere in there, I've forgotten exactly. But he's done talking to the Babylonians. He's done dealing with things that happened there in Babylon. He's talking prophecies that are primarily for the Israelites. He goes back to Hebrew. So, well, what was the end result of that prediction in Daniel 2? The king said, this is Daniel 2:47, the king said, your God is the greatest of all gods, the Lord over kings and the one who reveals mysteries. I know this because you have been able to explain this mystery. Was he converted?
Not really. A little bit.
Well, a little bit converted.
What was awesome about it, though, that nobody knew what the dream was. He had to, whoever came up with an answer had to explain what the dream was mm-hmm. also.
Yep.
So that would be pretty scary for somebody who fakes it.
Yeah.
You think Daniel had this figured out because of the story of Joseph? There was a similar situation back in Joseph's time. And the dream, you know, the Pharaoh had this dream and Joseph was able to interpret it, and Daniel said, hey, this is...
Well, I would just put it like this. I would say Daniel knew he had a relationship with God, and he knew that God had the answer. He knew there was no other way. Otherwise, the next day he was going to die. So what do you do?
Well, I can just imagine. How would it feel to go up to the king? He didn't say anything about what his dream is, and you start explaining it out of thin air, you know, because, well, the Lord impressed you and what it was, and you know that you're going to die if it's wrong, mm-hmm. you know. That's just pretty incredible to even yeah. think about.
And then in the next chapter, we'll go ahead.
Yeah. Well, the way you phrased that, I don't think you meant it that way, but it was like, oh my goodness, Daniel's can see he's going to die here, so he better do something to save himself.
Well,
and I think there was, I don't know.
It's
true. Maybe I better hurry up a little bit. Yeah. But I think
he was happy to represent God. He said, well, I know someone who is the answer to this that you don't know, and now I'm going to stand up and speak for my God. I think he did.
I don't think it was that confident. I think he was scared. He was shaking. He knew he had to have the right number. He knew that the God had to deliver the answer, mm-hmm. or else that's it. I mean, it's easy to read this and think that, oh, Daniel, oh my God, you know, he can fix everything. I'm not scared at all.
Yeah.
I don't think so. I think he shook in his boots and went through a lot.
Well, Daniel 3, the story of the burning fiery furnace and so forth, the statue that was put up there, and the king wants it all to be gold. He's hoping that his kingdom will never fail, et cetera, all that kind of stuff. Do you think the three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you think they had an idea what was going to happen when they got out there?
Oh, sure. I think so. And where was Daniel?
Well, we don't know.
I mean, he's a big official. He ought to be there, too. Did Daniel bow down?
Well, Daniel wasn't there.
Well, we don't know that for sure. It just doesn't mention him. Yeah. You know, lots of times, you know, when people fail, they just don't mention him. I'm not gonna say that he did bow down, but I'm just saying that you can't prove that he didn't either. Yeah.
So what was your question? Did they know what was going to happen?
When they got out there, what was going to happen?
Whether they were going to be required to bow down or whether
what
they
would happen if they didn't bow down?
I started to say a second ago is the furnace had to be well alight.
Yeah.
And then they made it even hotter, and you know it wasn't cold in the beginning. It was roaring somewhere. They would have seen the thing going.
Yeah.
I think they knew.
Well, at the end of that experience, the king again said, and there's a very interesting thing. He said, the fourth looks like what?
Son of God.
Well, if you read the King James Version, it says the Son of God. That's not what the Hebrew says. What does the Hebrew say?
I wouldn't have any idea.
Someone like the God.
A son of the gods.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Well, that would be more natural.
Ellen White puts it this way. How did that heathen king know what the Son of God was like? Well, the Hebrew captives filling positions of trust in Babylon had in life and character represented before him the truth. When asked for a reason of their faith, they had given it without hesitation. Plainly and simply, they had presented the principles of righteousness, thus teaching those around them of the God whom they worshipped. They had told of Christ, the Redeemer, to come, and in the form of the fourth, in the midst of the fire, the king recognized the Son of God. What do you think about that? So how much did Daniel and his friends know about the coming Messiah?
They knew something about it, and Christ obviously believed in the prophecies of Daniel himself, so it had been something around for quite a while.
Well, you know, Daniel 2 gives us a great deal about that future event, so... Did they have this information prior to Daniel 2?
Why wouldn't they? Didn't they have the Messiah? Wasn't the Messiah known about even before that?
Supposedly you've got most of the Old Testament. There's still parts of it that haven't been written. What are you going to refer to?
Has Genesis been written?
Yes.
Well, isn't that enough?
Well, depending on how you understand it.
Well, do you know exactly how they understood it?
No, but I'm saying, did they have a clear idea about the Messiah?
I think they did.
Apparently, they had probably a better idea than we realize.
I think Daniel is to the Old Testament what Revelation is to the New. Mm-hmm. And without Daniel, we would not be able to understand Revelation too well.
As well, yeah, for sure. Well, do you think that all four of those men, the ones that we know by name, do you think they all received visions from God?
You mean Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego as well?
Yeah.
I don't know if there's any record. Is there any record?
No.
Any intimation of that?
Mm-hmm. I'm just asking. little speculation.
Speculate?
I think they all had pretty solid relationships with God.
Yeah.
And it's not far-fetched to think that they were all potentially getting visions. It's hard for me to grasp that men that thought like this in this day at the Babylon National University, if they attended and they were trying to give this thought to, say, the professors of that day, and if we give the what we consider the right message today to our national universities, we would be laughed and scoffed at.
Probably.
So it's interesting to see them in that time period and being in that position.
Well, it says here in Daniel 2 that after King Daniel had found out what was going on, he went back to these companions and told them to seek mercy from the God of heaven concerning right. this mystery. So they were familiar with prayer. And
oh, yeah, for sure.
So the way you phrase that question of do you think they had visions, that implies that there's something real special about visions. You're really special if you have visions. Maybe there may be visions are just another tool in the toolbox. And
maybe they're like gifts. They only come to some mm-hmm. people and mm-hmm. not to others.
And often it would seem to me, I'm certainly not authority on this, but visions seem to come when usually pretty desperate circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like they come when things are in real good shape.
After Daniel 3, was God done with Nebuchadnezzar? What happened to Daniel 4?
He goes out to...
Is not this great Babylon
yes,
that I have
yes.
built? Right?
Yes.
And I, you know, there are places you can travel in the world. I visited some places just recently where there's still pieces of that great Babylon he's built that you can see, and they look pretty fine. The Archaeological Museum in Istanbul, walls full of that stuff. From the
Pergamon Museum, they have Gate of Ishtar there. That's amazing. You can walk in there. Daniel would walk through that stuff.
Yeah. Well, Daniel predicted now, King, there's going to be a time when you're going to be cut off. And Nebuchadnezzar was out there for 7 years like a wild animal. And what did he learn at the end of that time period?
Nebuchadnezzar became kind of a missionary in his own way.
When my sanity returned, my honor, my majesty, and the glory of my kingdom were given back to me. My officials and my noblemen welcomed me, and I was given back my royal power with even greater honor than before. And now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise, honor, and glorify the King of heaven. Everything he does is right and just, and he can humble anyone who acts proudly. I wonder who he was thinking about.
So was this a timeout for him to think over?
Well, it's also a timeout for him so that we can all learn the lesson.
Yeah. And then there was the experience of his grandson, Belshazzar. And what happened with him? The stories that we know about?
He didn't seem to learn too much from his dad's experiences.
Wasn't like Nebuchadnezzar.
Grandfather's experience. Yeah.
He was a good time boy.
Yeah. Yeah. And he just thought, no, we have this marvelous city with these great thick walls and nobody's going to be able to get in here. And they just marched right under those gates after deflecting the river and
practically everybody
walked in.
Practically everybody forgot all that stuff.
I think that answers your question you asked earlier about why are the youth leaving so rapidly or not being associated with Christianity. It doesn't take long after generations to totally forget and go on your own way.
Yeah. Well, they got real serious when they saw that hand writing on the wall. And it wasn't very long before probably everybody in that room was dead, except Daniel. Well, then we come to Daniel 6. All of a sudden, Daniel, for whatever reason, was recognized as being a wonderful statesman. I don't know what all he was recognized for, but Now he's in a high position in the new government, Medo-Persia. And what happens? Were all his associates happy to see him succeeding like that?
There's a lot of jealousy.
A lot of jealousy. And so they made that rule that couldn't be changed, the laws of the Medes and Persians. You got to worship only the king for a month. Daniel went home and opened his window and knelt down toward Jerusalem and prayed. And what was the result?
Well, technically they thought they had him.
Yeah. Well, of course, he was protected from the lions and so forth, and the king went out very early the next morning. He really appreciated the services that Daniel was giving. He liked Daniel. He was very upset when he realized that he'd been tricked into condemning Daniel to death. So here's his comments. Daniel 6, verse 25 to 27. Then King Darius wrote to the people of all nations, races, and languages on earth, "Greetings. I command that throughout my empire, everyone should fear and respect Daniel's God. He's a living God, and he will rule forever. His kingdom will never be destroyed, and his power will never come to an end. He saves and rescues. He performs wonders and miracles in heaven and earth. He saved Daniel from being killed by the lions. Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian." So,
the thing that amazes you about that whole thing is that Daniel obviously had a wide reputation,
mm-hmm.
a good reputation. And these other kings knew of him, apparently, before they got there.
And this king we're talking about now, he knew that Daniel was going to be, he thought there was a pretty good chance that Daniel would be protected by his God. So he didn't know just that Daniel was some strange creature that had worshipped a strange God. He had some knowledge about that God.
Of course, then the next question comes along, that there were other people like Daniel who faced lions and who were like the three Hebrew youth who said, well, maybe God will take care of us and maybe he won't, who ended up, they went into the similar experiences
mm-hmm.
with the same ideology, but the lions ate them up.
Mm-hmm.
So the next question is, you know, how come some people get it and some people don't?
Well, are we prepared? What happens when we face that kind of situation?
Well, I want to go into it with the same attitude and experience the same consequence. I want to come out. The lions are happy I was there, but didn't bother me any.
Yeah,
enjoyed my company, but left me alone.
I see. Well, there's a very, in the last part of Daniel, we can't leave the prophecies out. There's a very interesting prophecy in Daniel 7. And I'm going to just read a few verses of that prophecy. Daniel 7, starting with verse 9. While I was looking, thrones were put in place. One who had been living forever sat down on one of the thrones. Now, who would that be?
Jesus, Yahweh.
Well, presumably the Father God, right? His clothes were white as snow, and his hair was like pure wool. His throne, mounted on fiery wheels, was blazing with fire, and a stream of fire was pouring out from it. There were many thousands of people there to serve him, and millions of people stood before him. The court began its session, and the books were opened. And then if you drop down a few couple of verses, starting with verse 13, during this vision in the night, I saw what looked like a human being. He was approaching me, surrounded by clouds, and he went to the one who had been living forever and was presented to him. Now, who's that?
Now it's Jesus.
Christ.
Now it's Jesus. Mm-hmm. He was given authority, honor, and royal power so that the people of all nations, races, and languages would serve him. His authority would last forever, and his kingdom would never end. That's quite a picture. Here's God, the Father, sitting on a throne with millions of angels surrounding him, and Jesus is approaching looking like a human being. What does that suggest to us? Bring any suggestions to your minds?
From childhood, I remember being raised up that the fact that was one of the things that, I guess you'd say, Christ sacrificed, but he agreed to maintain the human bill that he had on earth. Albeit it had changed when he went back to heaven, but he still looked like a human being. Maybe that's it.
Okay.
So are we looking at something physical, or is the vision just transmitting a meaning by saying a person that looks like a man?
Well, either way, I think it's a message, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, look at a couple of passages. Look at Matthew 24, 14 to 16. And this good news about the kingdom will be preached to all the world for a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. You will see the awful horror of which the prophet Daniel spoke. It will be standing in the holy place. Note to the reader, be sure to understand what this means. Then those who are in Judea must run away to the hills. Okay? Notice some very interesting things. Now, there's a lot of people who believe that Daniel couldn't have predicted the future. In order to fit that into their understanding, they have to say it wasn't Daniel who wrote this book, but it was someone writing down about maybe 160 BC, writing really history now, and you know, that's it. But Jesus himself says, the awful horror of which the prophet Daniel, you will see. What tense is that?
Future.
In Jesus' day, you will see the awful horror of which the prophet Daniel spoke. So even if you say that Daniel wasn't written until 860 BC, you still got to have God predicting the future.
That's pretty solid logic. Unless Jesus wrote it later.
No, it didn't work like that.
Yeah.
It doesn't work like that. So, people who are trying to put the point is that people who are determined to believe what they want to believe are probably going to believe it anyway. But they have to do it. They have to fly directly in the face of a direct statement by Daniel and several direct statements by Daniel and direct statement by Jesus himself. So basically, you call him a liar.
Well, but they don't fly directly in the face because they don't read.
That's true.
If they would read and use common sense and reasonable logic like we have expressed here at the table, but they don't read.
Mm-hmm.
They don't make themselves available to the message.
Okay, now what are the chances that the second coming of Christ is awaiting? God is waiting to come until there are some 21st century Daniels.
I think it's quite plausible. You only got to look at the news every night and see what's happening in the Middle East.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, look at these verses from 2 Peter 3. I'm going to start with verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. On that day, the heavens will disappear with a shrill noise. The heavenly bodies will burn up and be destroyed. Now, we talked about a burning fiery furnace. This is way hotter than that. And the earth, isn't it?
The statement of shrill noise, I think, is almost laughable. If that's getting destroyed, you could have anything over your ears. It's still got to, it's just beyond imagination.
The earth with everything in it will vanish. Since all these things will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people should you be? Are you going to be Daniels or not going to be Daniels? Your lives should be holy and dedicated to God as you wait for the day of God and do your best to make it come soon. The day when the heavens will burn up and be destroyed and the heavenly bodies will be melted by the heat. Do we have anything to do with hastening or delaying the second coming?
It's been more delaying for quite a while.
More than 170 years now.
Yes.
Well, you can say that, can't you?
I did.
To work.
I did.
To work.
I did.
To hasten the Lord's coming. Mm-hmm. Doesn't that happen whether you actually do that or not?
Well, the Lord will come, but he will come because there will be some people who do what they're supposed to do.
So he's waiting on us.
He's waiting on us.
I don't believe that, but what I know what you're talking about. I know what you're saying.
And I've never been to these kind of institutions, but I've had occasion recently. I get all kinds of stuff through the mail, and you can get these DVDs and CDs to put in your car and read, and there's a lot about religion. Mm-hmm. And some of the finest lecturers in the universities around the country are noted for their knowledge. But when you look at the overview and all their different categories that they put in these lectures, if it wasn't for William Miller and what we've been given, there's hardly any of these people got even a notion of what's going on.
Yeah.
In Daniel and Revelation. Some of it they've obviously gotten close, but
well, I don't even think I think even our own church has gotten to the place where they think these mysterious things in Daniel and Revelation that we don't understand are too hard to understand, and and so
we just
don't even try to make an effort to understand them. And
listen to this experience of Daniel. It's found in Daniel 8, starting with verse 17. You think any modern people have had these kinds of experiences? Gabriel came and stood beside me, and I was so terrified that I fell to the ground. He said to me, "Mortal man, understand the meaning. The vision has to do with the end of the world." While he was talking, I fell to the ground unconscious, but he took hold of me and raised me to my feet and said, "I am showing you what the result of God's anger will be. The vision refers to the time of the end." That's our time he's talking about.
Well, that's what James White said.
Yeah.
And evidently he missed that.
So what do you think it means when he says God's anger will be revealed at the time of the end? Could that affect us?
Of course. Didn't Paul think the time of the end was imminent as
mm-hmm.
well?
Sure.
What do you mean by God's anger?
I just read it to you.
What does that mean?
That's what I'm asking you.
Well, what about, you know, there's ends and then there's ultimate ends.
Okay.
In Daniel's time, there was an end to the Jewish nation, at least for a while, and there was quite a bit of anger. And there are times when things come to an end, cultures come to an end, mm-hmm. And so forth, and usually those are pretty angry times.
Yeah.
So what am I getting at here?
Well, Daniel was in an involuntary situation, banishment from his home. How many others can you think of right away that were in the Bible who stood up and represented God who were in involuntary banishment?
Moses,
Joseph,
Jeremiah,
Esther.
List.
Well, quite a list.
There are people. Lots of people now who are fleeing for their lives mm-hmm. when we watch TV at night mm-hmm. and the news, banished from their homes and so forth. I can't help but believe that some of those people are, there are some people there who are truthful and faithful. Yes. And
I believe that. I believe there are some Daniels around. They've lived throughout time because mm-hmm. a lot of people would have died and are still dying because they want, just because they want to be Christian, and they take the risk.
Yeah, we're running out of time, but there's a couple more things I'd like to share from Ellen White here. Our lesson series for this 3 months focuses on issues around witnessing for God. Does God really expect us to witness as these ancient worthies did? And here's Ellen White's words. They're taken from Education, page 262. God's purpose for the children growing up beside our hearths is wider, deeper, higher than our restricted vision has comprehended. From the humblest lot, those whom he had seen faithful have in time past been called to witness for him in the world's highest places. And many a lad of today, growing up as did Daniel in his Judean home, studying God's word and his works and learning the lessons of faithful service, will yet stand in legislative assemblies and halls of justice or in royal courts as a witness for the King of Kings. Multitudes will be called to a wider ministry. The whole world is opening to the gospel. Ethiopia is stretching out her hands unto God. From Japan and China and India, from the still darkened lands of our own continent, from every quarter of this world of ours, comes the cry of sin-stricken hearts for a knowledge of the God of love. Millions upon millions have never so much as heard of God or of his love revealed in Christ. It is their right to receive this knowledge. They have an equal claim with us in the Savior's mercy, and it rests with us who have received the knowledge, with our children to whom we may impart it, to answer their cry. To every household and every school, to every parent, teacher, and child upon whom has shone the light of the gospel, comes at this crisis the question put to Esther the queen at that momentous crisis in Israel's history: who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this? Esther 4:14. Not many Bible scholars today are prepared to accept the fact that Daniel wrote his book, and we've already talked about that. These prophecies have, of course, been used by Seventh-day Adventists many times to teach why we believe what we believe. But Daniel and his three friends were taken to the courts of Babylon. We think about what happened to them. Think about what could happen to us, what is happening to some Adventists today in some parts of the world, and realize that the days of Daniel, the times of Daniel, the things that happened to them are not that far-fetched. They could happen again, and let me assure you, that kind of stuff will happen again. It will happen again in our day if we're faithful witnesses and missionaries as God calls us to be. Our kind and loving Father, we thank you so much for the privilege of reading your word, of learning from these ancient stories the truths that can help us to be more firm and steadfast in our faith. May it serve its purpose as our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.